the personal God, as pure existence, himself belongs to manifestation, and cannot therefore be called absolutely unconditioned. Only that which is beyond both existence and non-existence can be understood as really unconditioned. So also for Buddhism, this is the extreme point of reference, not the belief in existence, not the belief in non-existence. Attachment to one or other of these is a bond, a limitation. This view is well illustrated in the texts by means of various similes. But there is a much more striking story, molded with the power of a Michelangelo. It is called The Visit to Brahma. While I was staying once at Ukatha in the Subhaga Grove under the great saw tree, Brahma conceived the pernicious view that his world was everlasting, complete in itself, that in his world there was no birth, decay, death, or further existences, nor was there any other salvation beyond it. Reading his thoughts, I vanished from beneath the saw tree to reappear in his particular Brahma world.
Here is the eternal, here is the persistent, here is the everlasting, here is indissolubility and immutability. Here there is no birth, nor old age, nor death, nor passing away and reappearance, and another, higher liberation than this, there is not.
The worthy Brahma is in error should he affirm that the impermanent is eternal, that there is no higher liberation than this, when there is another liberation beyond it. But here Mara the malign, the god of craving and of death, intervenes. He enters into one of the celestial beings in Brahma's retinue, and from here speaks to the Buddha. O monk, beware of him. He is Brahma, the omnipotent, the invincible, the all-seeing, the sovereign, the Lord, the creator, the preserver, the father of all that has been and of all that will be. Long before you there were in the world ascetics and priests who were enemies of the elements, of nature, of the gods, of the Lord of generation, of Brahma. These, at the dissolution of the body, when their vital strength was exhausted, came to abject forms of existence. And therefore I counsel you, O ascetic, beware, O worthy one. What Brahma has said to you, accept it, lest you contradict the word of Brahma. Should you, O ascetic, contradict the word of Brahma, it would be as though a man were to approach a rock and beat on it with a stick, or as though a man, O ascetic, were to fall into an infernal abyss and to seek to grasp the earth with his hands and feet. Thus, O monk, would it befall you.
I, O worthy one, hold as eternal that which is truly eternal, as persistent, as perennial, as indissoluble, as immutable, that which is truly so. And where there is no birth and decay, nor death, nor passing away and reappearance, of this I say. Here truly there is no birth, nor decay and death, nor passing away and reappearance. And since there is no other, higher liberation, therefore I say, there is no other, higher liberation. Therefore, O monk, speak if you will, you will certainly not discover another higher liberation, try as you will. If you take the earth, if you take the elements as your standpoint, then you have taken me as your standpoint. You have taken me as your basis. You must obey me. You must yield to me. If you take, O monk, nature, the gods, the lord of generation as your standpoint, then you have taken me as your standpoint. You have taken me as your basis. You must obey me. You must yield to me. If you take, O monk, Brahma as your standpoint, then you have taken me as your standpoint. You have taken me as your basis. You must obey me. You must yield to me.
At this point, the antitheses build up to a cosmic and titanic grandeur, ending with a most paradoxical reversal of the point of view that is prevalent in Western religions. In fact, whilst the desire of surpassing the very Lord of creation, from this point of view, appears as something diabolical, the Buddha, instead, finds a diabolical plot in the exact opposite, that is, in the attempt to stop him in the region of being, to make this region an insuperable limit, beyond which it is both absurd and mad to seek a higher liberation. Here it is the malign one in person who urges the belief that the personal God, the God of being, is the supreme reality, and who threatens the Buddha with the damnation that is supposed already to have claimed other ascetics. But the Buddha discovers the plot and speaks thus to Mara. Well I know you, malign one. Abandon your hope. He knows me not. You are Mara, the malign. And this Brahma here, O malign one, these gods of Brahma, these celestial companies of Brahma, they are all in your hand. They are all in your power. You, O malign one, certainly think he also must be in my hand, in my power. I, however, O malign one, am not in your hand. I am not in your power. There follows a symbolical test. The personal God, the Hebraic I am that I am, the God of being, whose essence is his existence, as such, cannot not be. That is, he is bound to being. He is passive with respect to being. He has not the power to go beyond being. It is here that the test occurs. Who can disappear? That is, who is Lord both of being and of non-being? Who rests neither on the one nor on the other? Brahma, I have realized the earth to be the earth it really is, and having known that which does not fall within experience of earth, I did not identify with earth. I did not say, earth is mine. I did not enjoy earth. Brahma, I have realized water to be the water it really is, and having known that which does not fall within experience of water, I did not identify with water. I did not say water is mine. I did not enjoy water. Brahma, I have realized all to be the all it really is, and having known that which does not fall within experience of the all, I did not identify with all. I did not say all is mine.
If you have known something which does not fall within experience of the all, take heed it prove not merely empty and vain. Consciousness, invisible, boundless, all illumined, is also not touched by earth or water. It cannot be reached by the allness of the all. And now I shall vanish from the ascetic Gotama's view.
Vanish, if you can, Brahma. I can still see you. You're behind the mountain. And now I shall vanish from Brahma's view.
Vanish if you can.
Then by the exercise of such magical powers as would let Brahma and his host hear me without seeing me, I disappeared, repeating these lines. Seeing the danger in continued existence, that life and any existence will cease to be, I didn't welcome any kind of existence, and I didn't grasp at relishing. Brahma cannot disappear. Instead, the Buddha disappears. All the world of Brahma is amazed and recognizes the high power, the high might of the ascetic Gotama. limitation is removed. The dignity of the Atideva, of one who goes beyond the world of existence itself, not to mention the celestial worlds, is demonstrated. It is only left to Mara the Malign to try in vain to dissuade the Buddha from spreading the doctrine. Here, then, is one of the extreme points in the test of the vocations. Not to crave even the highest of all lives, not only to pass from this shore to the other, but to apprehend that which lies beyond both. The words of the Awakened One are, "Nature, the gods, the Lord of generation, Brahma, the resplendent ones, the powerful ones, the ultra-powerful ones, all things I have known, how unsatisfying are all things. This have I recognized, and I have renounced all things, abdicated from all things, detached myself from all things, forsworn all things, disdained all things. And in this, O Brahma, not only am I your equal in knowledge, not only am I not less than you, but I am far greater than you."